our dear viewers and welcome you to a new edition of Body and Soul. In today's edition, we are going to talk about the families, the values of the families. The family is love and also it's a mental burden. Many have been said about the importance of family ties and the rewards of having a family. And that is despite of the great emotional advantages of having a family, it comes, of course, at a price. Worries about the physical, mental, and emotional well-being of the offspring come along with the daily hassle of the piling up, sometimes threatening the whole establishment of the mental well-being of the whole family members and the parents, of course. To shed more light about the family, the values, and the hassle of being a parent and a family member, we have the following report by Samah Al-Sharif.
The invisible workload that drags women down, that was what Lisa Wade wrote in an online article. She says, I am the person who notices we are running low on coffee pods. I am the person who notices we are running low on toothpaste, dental floss, mouthwash, anti-cavity rinse in bubble gum flavors. I am the person who notices we are running low on granola bars, brownie bites, dried fruit, kale chips, cheese sticks, Pepperidge Farm goldfish, and other life-saving snacks. Sociologist Susan Walzer published a research article in 1996 called Thinking About the Baby. Walzer found that women do more of the intellectual, mental, and emotional work of childcare and household maintenance. They do more of the learning and information processing, like researching pediatricians. They do more worrying, like wondering if their child is hitting his developmental milestones. And they do more organizing and delegating, like deciding when the mattress needs to be flipped or what to cook for dinner, even when their male partners helped out by doing their fair share of chores and errands. It was the women who noticed what needed to be done.
Welcome back, our dear viewers. As we have promised at the beginning of the show, now today we are going to talk about the family. To what extent family is an important factor and an important thing in our lives? To what extent family is representing real love, although it's happiness and real love, but sometimes it is considered to be somehow a burden on the family members. To shed more light, we are very much delighted to have our dear guest in the studio, Dr. Zeynep Shaheen. She is the professor of sociology and women development consultant. Hello, Dr. Zeynep.
Hello, thanks for inviting me for such an important topic.
Indeed.
Rightly said, it's a very important institution, family institution is very important, basic unit in society. This is one of the main functions of the family, is socialization of individual to become our people and our society members in the future. So to the family lays a great deal of effort in order to cater to the interest of the development of healthy individuals in society, constructive individuals. So I'm very happy with this topic.
Indeed. Dr. Zeynep, to start with, from your point of view, what are the psychological and emotional return of having a family?
A family is a very important institutions, as I said before. The provision of emotional support, the provision of different kinds of support to individual family members is very important. Because to the family, you relate to the family, you have someone to talk to, you have someone to express your pleasures, to express your agonies, to express different emotions, and you have someone to cater, or some people to cater to the interest of your needs. So it's a very important institution.
Indeed. Doctor, how do you weigh the severity of emotional and mental burden that come along with the creation of a family?
Well, before we deal with this topic, with this issue, I would like to stress the importance of having bondage in the family, having integration in the family. There are so many important, there are important factors contributing to this integration, which is an imperative to having a psychological and mental well-being. factors contributing to the bondage of the family, factors contributing to the to healthy families, to strong families, mm-hmm. to the strength of the families is that of having a sense of appreciation. Mm-hmm. I appreciate very much your selecting this topic. By the mm-hmm. same token, family members, you need to be appreciated by your partners, mm-hmm. by your spouse, by your children. Mm-hmm. I meet so many women that would say, oh, I go out of my way, I forget my needs, I prioritize their needs and mm-hmm. and demands before they come before mm-hmm. my own needs, whether it's the spouse or the children, mm. and I don't see any sense of appreciation, any kind mm. of appreciation.
It's very alarming here, Dr. Zainab, and allow me to interrupt you. You are saying that sometimes the parents here, the mother or the father, they do not feel appreciated. Maybe the woman by her spouse, or the man by his wife, or the mother by her children. So how can we deal with such a factor?
I believe strongly in expressing oneself freely and openly. Mm. I don't want the women to contain this in their system, and or men or husbands, wives, children, they have to express it. And that's why I think that communication is very important media for expressing your needs and priorities and your complaints and your sense of frustration because you're not appreciated. That's why I always recommend that family members spend time together, mm-hmm. and when you spend time together, you're ultimately going to communicate, mm-hmm. and communication and rapport is very important. Communication, dialogue, mm-hmm. rapport is very important because you really express your needs and priorities and your agonies, your frustrations, mm-hmm. so this is a way to deal with it. Mm-hmm. Something also I would like to mention in this context, that always the time is an important factor to spend together with family members, but you have to bear in mind
yes.
that it is not quantity of time.
Yeah, that was my question. It has to be quality time. How
quality
can
time.
We provide quality time for the family members?
I just said we through real communication. You have to understand the in order to motives, the because of motives, why did you do this? Well, because when you find out the reason, you are going to ultimately feel relaxed because you don't have piled anger against family members. Mm. You're going to understand their motivation, their reasons for that. And so you can give a lot of excuses. You can accommodate all this unwanted behavior or unwanted activity that raised a lot of frustration to other members.
What about the failed expectations, Dr. Zainab? Sometimes I do expect many things from my spouse. Sometimes I do expect many things from my children. And in return, that's not what I'm getting. So how can we overcome this somehow sort of disappointment?
Well, again and again and again, I would say through communication, through expressing of one's you have to express yourself, you have to express your anger, you have to express your happiness, expression, get it out of your system. Mm-hmm. So this is, I think, it's a very important approach to ameliorate any challenges to the well-being of the family.
Indeed.
I would like to seize this opportunity and talk something concerning what is the basis of a healthy family, strong families. A healthy relationship among
Indeed.
Among
please
family members. Before dealing with the family, you have to deal with choice of marriage.
The beginning,
right?
The choice
right
of the spouse.
Exactly. I always emphasize the notion that they have to be of similar cultural, socio-economic background. They have to be of similar. They don't have to be identical, but they have to be to have a similarity. You mentioned value system in your introduction, and I strongly believe that one of the important factors contributing to healthy relationship among family members is that of similar value system, similar values. Mm. Because in many instances, I would find husbands, for example, very angry of something which is taken by wives as something very simple, something very normal, something shouldn't create that much anger. But it is not because of sex differences, different
background.
It is because of different background and not because of
gender
difference. So you have to be as much as you can in your selection of your selection of the meat is to be as much similar as possible, similar background, educational, economic, social, and most importantly, value system. Also, by the same token, I would like to emphasize so many instances, there are so many problems, and they are not allowing factors to intervene. For instance, I have just come out of a marital conflict with acquaintance, and they would say that I did all what I could, and she's not happy, and she would say the same thing, and that she's not happy. But they don't know that there are external pressures, and this is should be underlined. There are so many societal pressures, external pressures exerted on individuals, and many times they believe that it is because of the individual partner, because of the spouse, because of the children. It is not because of that. It is because of external factors. For instance, if a man goes out in the morning and gets into the bus, street bus, and finds a lot of problems at work, and then comes to buy food items, and they are very expensive. So this creates a lot of frustration, and he gets it out of his system towards his wife. So sometimes we have to learn that problems are not necessarily emanating from individual members. They are imposed on individuals because of external pressures.
Dr. Zainab, what, from your point of view, are the factors contributing to the disintegration of the family and could lead to divorce?
First and foremost is that of gender roles, gender sex roles, the change in gender roles and sex roles. In many instances, during the last few decades, there were a lot of changes in women's roles, men's roles, gender roles, and yet the expectations remain the same. One of my students, a couple of my students, got married a few years ago, and they got divorced after 6 months, and I was taken by surprise. It sounded like a great marriage, and the choice was very compatible. They were compatible and so on. And I understood from what they expressed is that he expected his wife to play the role of his exactly played by his mother. She doesn't prepare my clothes when I go out. She doesn't prepare my shirt, my suit, my shoes. I asked him, why don't you do it yourself? No, I wouldn't, because my mother did it for my daddy. But she is not acting the same role as your mother. Your mother was a housewife, period. But she is acting dual roles outside and inside the house. So you have to bear in mind that he couldn't take it because it is already internalized in his system that this is the role of a wife.
Indeed.
So gender roles, the change in gender roles, gender role conflict has to be borne in mind. They have to realize that don't have the same expectations, and that society changes, cultural expectation changes, so they have to change.
Indeed. Dr. Zainab, will get back to the point of gender and how it could have an effect on the marriage. But first, we'll take this phone call with Dr. Ali Kamel. He is professor of psychiatry. Dr. Ali? Hi, sir. Sir, can you talk about the psychological and emotional return of having a family?
Of course, as a family, we have to have something. We can have no big emotions and no much criticizing in the family. Of course, the responsibility and the question is about can you ask me the question?
About the importance of the emotional and psychological importance of having a family.
Of course, family is very important because it's a support to the person. As we know in psychology and in psychiatry, we know that the rate of suicide in single is much higher than married, which means that when you get married, you have somebody with you, and you have some equilibrium in the family. So this is number one. Number two, depression and anxiety is less in family than in single, when you live alone. Because you have somebody with him you can discuss, you can have exposing your transference. In psychoanalysis also, we know that the family important for giving psychological support to the individual. So I think family interaction, family communication, family meta-communication is very, very important.
Indeed. Sir, yes, sir. What are the women's most stressful worries about the family?
Sorry, your question about...
Yes. What are the women's most stressful worries about the family?
You mean the worry of the women?
Yes, right? The mother, the wife.
Yes, of course. The wife is very, very important because she is the one who is responsible for the children, if they got the children, or in the Oriental culture, like in Egypt, she also takes care of the men. And she has a lot of burden, psychological burden on her life. So she did a lot of effort to make a certain equilibrium in adjustment in the family. The role of women in the family is very important, but sometimes some women are exposed to violence from men or from the children or from other people. And that's why I think it's very important to support and to give help to women in the Egyptian family. As you know, in France, for example, in Paris, we have movements like what we call MMM, in French, which means that they take in consideration the work, the role of the woman in the family, like work, and important work, and some women look for getting salary to being wife, not only to go out to work to get a salary from other sources. This movement in Paris, in France, call it MMM, which is Mouvement Mondial de Mère, which means movement, worldwide movement for mothers.
Mothers, indeed.
And of course, according to the statistics, Egyptian women do a hard work in the house, and the housewife is very, very important for the support of the husband and the children.
Indeed, Dr. Ali Kamel, Professor of Psychiatry, thank you very much. And back to our dear guest in the studio, Dr. Zina.
I have a very short comment.
Yes, please.
The doctor said that the role of women in the family is very important, etc., etc. Now we have to charge that. But I would like to emphasize and underline that the role of men is equally important.
Indeed, of course.
It should be sharing because there is this discrimination, this division. This is household activities should be
woman done by the mother, or
and working and spending on the family, earning and spending is a man's role. There must be sharing between both. It's not either or, and that's why I believe that one of the problems of the family relationship, husband-wife, spouse relationship, is that they have been raised in different worlds altogether. They have different world experience, different ethos, different world view, different orientation in life. And that's why sometimes it's very difficult for them to cope with problems, crisis, because they learned how to deal with it differently in such separated sex roles, separated sex worlds.
Indeed.
Again, this we have to bear in mind, and when we raise them in a similar manner. Household activities should not only be woman-bound. It is both sexes, earning and spending and sharing, be done by both, not only by one.
Yes. Dr. Zainab, as you have kindly mentioned that the role of woman and the role of man, the role of the husband and the wife should see somehow a certain integration. which is not always the case, unfortunately, in Egypt and the Arab world. We just put in a frame that the woman should be the one who is doing most of the activities at home and to study for the kids. And how can we start to change these perceptions? And I do believe that the mothers are somehow are the ones to blame in raising their male kids.
There is nothing, I should not say that mothers are responsible.
Some mothers, of course.
We are socialized the same, men and women, boys and girls, infants are socialized in the same way. Self-conception of women is similar to how men perceive women, and by the same token, men's perception of themselves is similar on how society members perceive them, so that we were all raised in the same pot. So it is not a matter of women themselves should be blamed or women should are responsible or men are responsible. It is a societal activity. It is a societal responsibility. We have to start changing our taken for granted assumptions about sex roles. You have just asked me who is to be blamed or how can we ameliorate this condition? How can we change this?
Yes.
Change takes time. Values die hard. Old habits die hard. But we have to keep at it because it is not undermining men's masculinity if he undertakes domestic chores. And by the same token, it's not impeding her femininity if she works and contributes to family income because of the need. Now she should do it more so now. So it's a matter of how changes of our orientation, changes of our values, expectations of men, expectations of women, sex role expectations, this should be changed. It will not happen overnight, but it takes time, but it is very important to happen. Something else I would like
please,
to
Dr.
because it is reflecting complaints I hear a lot from husbands and wives, routine life. They keep mentioning that life becomes
boring and
monotonous
depressing.
And repetitive and redundant and routine. So I also suggest in this context that they have one day just for recreation, just go outing, leave their place for some time, seize opportunities for holidays. It doesn't have to be that expensive, but they have to do the right step in order to change the regular pattern, because change is very important to create vitality in marital life.
Dr. Zina, but what would be your advice for a sound family life? Here I want some tips for both kids as well.
I was just done with the research that I read that religious families are more prone to happiness than non-religious families.
Why?
Because of the values instilled in religions, values of giving, values of forgiving, values of mercy and love, mu'adda wa rahma. All these values are very much contributing to the welfare of the family and to healthy relationship, eliminating disputes and eliminating problems. So maybe because of that, but I was very much interested in reading this material because it showed how religious family in this particular study was more prone to healthy marriage as opposed to non-religious ones.
To what extent, Dr. Zina, the economic factors are representing a factor in the happiness or the bond in the family between the different members?
Well, the more they are committed, the more they are knowledgeable of each other's needs and priorities, the more they are sharing and embracing their marital life on love and mercy, I think this can be dealt with because they are sharing how coping with this crisis, coping with this problem. But if there is not this kind of background, they'll probably create a hassle over the raising expenses and life, new kind of pressure on them.
What about the education, Dr. Zina?
Again, there must be a very similar educational background. They must, it is very inconvenient, very unlikely to communicate properly or understand each partner properly when there is an educational gap. One is just barely high school diploma and the other maybe a PhD. There must be some kind of similarity in the educational standard.
Mm-hmm. So, Dr. Zainab, the family at the end is more of a source of happiness than a burden. But sometimes we do not feel the value of the family until maybe we are grown a bit old, or the kids are grown-ups and each one is gone to his house. And at the end, sometimes we do feel loneliness. Maybe if the mother and father
I think the spouses passes away. The value of the family right from the beginning, but more so when the individual members face these situations, you are right. And no one can challenge the importance and value of the family, because it is really creating a lot of support. It is a support system to the members, economically, socially, and emotionally.
Indeed.
I think they do feel it.
Indeed, Dr. Zainab Shaheen, our professor of sociology and women development consultant, thank you very much for being our guest for today. And with that, our dear viewers, we come to the end of this edition of Body and Soul. Hope you have enjoyed it. Meet again.